This is ODAAT Chat, your instant connection to recovery and community, one day at a time. This podcast may contain strong language, sexual content, and spiritual truth. Listener discretion is advised.
Hi, friend. Welcome to another episode of the ODAAT Chat Podcast. My name is Arlina, and I'll be your host. After taking a break for a couple weeks, I decided to kick off this next series with a solo episode to talk about holding safe space and the process of letting go of secrets so that you can live free of guilt and shame. I'm going to walk you through how all this came about for me, just the whole process of talking about holding safe space, and what the process of letting go looks like for me and how you can do it too. There'll actually be a free downloadable worksheet available on my website at soberlifeschool.com. So this came up because I went to a meeting where the topic was the fourth step. And for those of you who don't know, it's the fourth out of the 12 steps of Alcoholics Anonymous. It's a searching and fearless moral inventory ourselves. Naturally, people also talked about the fifth step, which is sharing that inventory. So that process of sharing the inventory, it's kind of like confession, but it's about identifying cause and effect as well. So, and when you go through that process with somebody who's also struggled with drugs and alcohol, there's something about that peer-to-peer. It's not like somebody's looking down on you. It's like talking to somebody who knows exactly what it's like, someone who gets my kind of crazy, that feels safer to me. So let me just share what the process with you looks like. So, and I'm taking this right out of what they call the big book, right? It's the book of Alcoholics Anonymous. And like I said, you can take notes or there'll be a downloadable worksheet. But basically what it is, it's a writing process. You take a sheet of paper and fold it into four columns. The first column will be reserved for the person that you're resentful at. The second column is, what is the very specific cause? And the third column is, how does it affect you? What is the effect? This is about cause and effect. And then the final part is, what is your part? That goes into the fourth column. So this is probably the hardest part, the fourth column. And this is often where people need help, because when we're hurt, we're focused on our pain. It's hard to see how other people, those that have hurt us, might actually be responding to something that we've actually done. You know, where are we at the cause, right? And so that's really where it's important to have a guide to help us see that part. And this is really often where most people get tripped up. And, you know, that's totally normal. And that's why it's so important to have a guide. So I'll even give you a personal example. I have a million of them, but I'll just give you one that's sort of lighthearted. You know, it seems kind of small, but it had deep roots. And it was actually hitting on a lot of my core issues of not feeling good enough and money and control and relationships. So that's why I decided to share this particular one. I'm calling it just the tip. it's not what you think. But anyway, here it goes. So the person I was resentful at was Bob, my now husband, but we were just engaged at the time. This was years ago. And the cause was that he gave this huge tip that I didn't think that we could afford. We were saving for our wedding. And the effect was, it affected my self-esteem. It affected my personal relationship with him. It hit both financial and emotional security. And underlying all of this was fear that I wasn't going to get what I wanted. So let me just break down the whole situation for you. So he and I were engaged and we did a double date and we went to a restaurant and we were with this other couple and this other guy was kind of I don't know if I would call him a high roller, but he had plenty of money and we got great service. And I just felt like, you know, that guy was kind of showing off and he decided to give this waitress a huge tip. They were kind of joking about it, like, hey, let's give this girl a really big tip. And I got so uncomfortable because I was already in fear that we were spending too much money on dinner and, you know, that he was going to spend money that we couldn't afford. And I tried to make light of it and say something about it, like, oh, you don't need to do that. You know, you don't need to, I don't remember what I said. It was a long time ago. But the outcome was I made everybody feel uncomfortable. I embarrassed my then fiance, and, you know, the guy who was giving the big tip was, you know, it was like my husband and this guy against me. And my girlfriend was really uncomfortable and she was trying to be supportive of me, but I just made it awkward for everyone. And, you know, by the end of the, that was pretty much the end of the evening. We went our separate ways and I was pissed. I was so angry that I felt like he took that, you know, he cared about what the waitress thought and felt more than I did. He cared about what that, how that guy felt more than he cared how I felt. And it was a terrible experience. So I had to take this to my sponsor and she and I talked it over and, you know, she was objective about this whole thing, right? She's not emotionally attached to any of it. So, and what I have found is that when we're emotional, we're not objective about the situation. You know, I was focused on my pain and I was self-righteous and angry. So she kind of broke it down for me. She helped me to see that I was willing to trade my peace for a very small amount of money. Let's just say it was $20. I don't remember how much it was. I was willing to trade my peace over $20. I was willing to hang on to a resentment towards my then fiance over a small amount of money. She helped me to see that, you know, this is his life too, and he gets to spend his money the way he chooses to. And I need to learn how to respect that. And that I was being, you know, very controlling. And anyway, she and I talked it over, and the more we talked about it, the more I realized that it was so petty to be so angry and make such a big deal out of something that wasn't a big deal. And that, you know, it was tempting for me to, once I saw my part, and acknowledge how I must have made everybody else feel. I felt like such a jerk. You know, when the anger wore off and I was able to get in touch with how I must have made the other people feel, you know, I was really tempted to feel so much guilt and shame and embarrassment. And she stopped me. You know, she was like, you know what? I know that you want your wedding to be beautiful, and it's going to be beautiful. You're going to be able to save the money that you need to save. And it's not about the money. It's not about the stuff. You're going to have a beautiful day. And, you know, she stopped me from beating myself up too much. She stopped me. She helped me to just stay right-sized, you know, not to get too into anger and not to get too low. So, and I know, I realize this is sort of like, you know, a small example, but it hit on some really core issues because it all fed into, I'm not worthy. I'm not good enough. Like, other people's feelings are more important than mine. And the one person who I thought was on my side, you know, it didn't feel like he was on my side at the time. So that's kind of how, like, it, what it all triggered. And it ran deep. Money issues and respect, and those are deep issues. So I needed a way to be able to, you know, resolve that resentment. And meanwhile, he did the same process with his people. You know, he went to his guys and they talked about it. And, you know, as we came together, we had a plan to move forward and how we were going to manage our money. And it was a painful process, but it has been the process that he and I have used over, you know, 20 plus years in our relationship. The point I want to drive home here is that I had a guide. I had somebody that could provide a safe space for me so that I could go through my petty little issues and figure out what was my part and what wasn't, what could I do differently. And I was so grateful that I had that person. And, you know, there were much bigger issues too in recovery that I had to deal with, but that's where it started. I started by sharing the small things with her, and it grew to the point where I was able to release all my guilt and shame. So I started, you know, after this meeting that I went to where they were talking about this, I drove away thinking, you know, I am so grateful that I have this process, but I also recognize just from doing the podcast and being in the online recovery community, you know, Facebook groups and things like that, that not everybody is able to, some people are just not able to drop the rock or share the secret, you know, and they say that we're only as sick as our secrets, you know. And I got to thinking, what do other people do? What do other people do when they don't feel like they can share their secrets, you know, within their community, like within their circle of friends or at the meetings they go to? What if they don't feel like they have somebody? This is where I can help. What I want you to know is that if you are holding onto a secret that you want freedom from, I'm able to hold safe space for you. And this is how it'll work. You can go to soberlifeschool.com and look for the course called holding safe space. And you can register to book time with me via a Zoom online meeting. Once you place your order, you will receive a link to my calendar and you can choose a time that works for you. And just so you know, I only have a very limited amount of time to do this. I'll need to save them for people who are truly ready to be free. Also, because of the number of spots will be very limited, registration will only be open for the next 7 days. If the spots fill up quickly, then I'll provide a wait list and you'll be notified as soon as space becomes available. If you're ready to drop the rock and experience freedom from guilt and shame, then sign up now to lock in your spot. Once you do, you'll receive a link to schedule your appointment. And listen, I know this is a scary proposition, but I want to encourage you to share the secret and find empathy and forgiveness. Whether it's me or you have a friend you can trust, a therapist, or a religious person you feel safe with, I want you to take a leap of faith and let it all go. What helped me to finally let it all go was thinking about what it would cost me if I didn't let it go. It would cost me my self-esteem. It would cost me my hopes and my dreams because I knew I would never allow myself to really receive the love I desperately needed to heal as long as I held on to my guilt and condemnation. So today could be your day. Reach out to me or someone else and take that next step. Do it scared if you have to, because that actually means you have courage. It also means you are ready to heal and therefore help others to heal as well. I'm here if you need me, and thank you so much for spending this time with me today. One last thing before you go, if you enjoyed the podcast today, please don't forget to subscribe on iTunes or Stitcher and leave a review. And if you'd like to make a donation to the podcast and help me keep the lights on, you can do so by visiting odaatchat.com. There's a donation button or membership button on the right-hand side. Have a great day. Thank you so much for joining us.